Welcome to Congress Hall in Independence National Historical Park. My name is Cindy McLeod, and I'm superintendent here at Independence. I think it is just splendid that the World Affairs Council wanted to return to this wonderful room as part of what we're calling our centennial anniversary programming. You may have heard our awareness campaign. Do any of you tweet? Hashtag find your park. It's our goal this centennial year to help everyone understand that the National Park Service needs them to help make our next 100 years sustainable. We need you to support and enjoy the parks. Some people will find their special places in Yellowstone or Mount Rushmore. Some might find it at Hamilton's home or the Statue of Liberty in New York City. Others might find it in the Everglades. But it's clear to me that you all have found yours at Independence National Historical Park. We're so happy to have you here in Congress Hall, next door to the more famous Independence Hall. And if any of you all haven't had a tour here in this building, there are so many wonderful stories, so come back. And even if you've been here, you might not have heard the ones that the ranger might tell you. Although New York City can proudly boast that it became the first capital city under our Constitution, and although Washington, D.C. has been our nation's capital for over 200 years, for 10 very significant years, the vibrant city of Philadelphia served as our nation's capital. This building was the temporary home to Congress from 1790 to 1800. I don't think I probably have to tell you that. But you are seated in the House of Representatives. The Senate met upstairs. The President lived a block away. The first bank of the United States was built just two blocks away. Many of the movers and can you imagine the pressure on this generation, this brand new government? I can try to imagine. All individuals involved must have been aware of the stakes at the time. Would they succeed or would they fail? What led up to the period of development for this building in our young nation? I think we'll explore some of that era together tonight, and so I am very happy to introduce to you Craig Snyder.
Thank you, Cindy, for your welcome on behalf of Independence National Historical Park. What an honor it is for us at the World Affairs Council to be back in this space. This is our third year in a row, and we are especially delighted to be here in, as Cindy noted, during the centennial celebration of the National Park Service, which does so much to make American heritage come alive for the present and to preserve it for the future. We're here tonight to present another installment in the Stan and Arlene Ginsberg Family Foundation Great Debates series. I want to thank the Park Service representatives here for their support and cooperation in making the event possible, in putting this together, as well as Stan and Arlene Ginsberg, Amatec, UGI Corporation, and SEI Private Wealth Management for their support of this series, which we think is particularly impactful for our audiences. Before I introduce tonight's speaker, I want to say just one word about the exciting event we have coming up just next week on Monday. As most of you are probably aware at this point, on Monday the Council will be hosting a luncheon with the Chair of the Federal Reserve Board, Dr. Janet Yellen. Seats are pretty much sold out, but if you are still interested in attending and haven't yet registered, please see one of our staff or call our offices tomorrow to join our waiting list. Alternatively, we will also be live streaming Dr. Yellen's address on the internet, so details for how to access that can be found on our website. A couple of housekeeping notes about tonight. All of you here will receive a copy of our guest's book as you exit from this room, and those of you who are attending our cocktail reception, that will commence at 7:30 across the street at the Hotel Monaco. So on to tonight's program. Joseph Ellis is one of the nation's leading historians. The author of 9 books, he's received a Pulitzer Prize and National Book Award in recognition of his work. His most recent book, titled The Quartet, Orchestrating the Second American Revolution, 1783 to 1789, is the subject of our conversation tonight. This is the story of the second founding of the United States of America, how George Washington, Alexander Hamilton, John Jay, and James Madison, and maybe some others that we'll mention, worked to make 13 separate states unite under one government after the end of the Revolution. I can't think of a more appropriate place, I don't think there is a more appropriate place, to hear this story than in the building that saw many of the results of that second revolution. And I can't think of a more appropriate time in which to consider the historical issues of leadership, of compromise, and of the design of a government able to endure human folly than our present political season. With that, please join me in welcoming Dr. Joseph Ellis.
Thank you for that gracious introduction. I feel truly honored. This is the closest thing to sacred space that's allowed in a secular republic. My understanding is I should talk for about 10 or 15 minutes and give you the gist of a story that I want you to know. And it's one that I don't think you know. And then I'm to sit down and be interrogated. And all the holes poked in my story as possible. And then we'll even open it to further comments and ridicule and whatever it may be. Let me ask you a question. What's the most famous speech in American history? People say Gettysburg Address. If it was a younger audience, some of you would say, I have a dream speech. Some of you would say, Kennedy's first only inaugural. If you're really, really, really into it, Lincoln's second inaugural is the most profound statement by a president in that genre. But Gettysburg Address. The first clause in the first sentence of the most famous speech in American history is historically incorrect. Let us say the words together. 47 years ago, our fathers brought forth on this continent a new nation. No, they didn't. They brought forth the Confederation, the sovereign states, provisionally united to win the war and then go their separate ways, which is what they did. We were not a nation in 1776. Now, Lincoln has an awful lot of interest in convincing people that we were, since in 1863, the whole case for the Civil War rested on the notion that the Confederacy could not secede because the Union pre-existed the states, which in fact they didn't. Now, the Confederacy had a pretty strong argument, and I'm a Virginian, but I'm making this as a historian here. If you think about it, the motion in these spaces for independence on July 2nd came from Virginia's Richard Henry Lee, which said that these colonies are and have every right to be independent states. And if you think back to the arguments that have been hurled the preceding 10 years by the American colonies against Parliament, the arguments were that Parliament could not tax or legislate in the end for the colonies because that right belonged to the colonial legislatures, right? And so when you create the first government, which isn't really a government, under the Articles of Confederation, sovereignty rests with the states. They have a big debt. When you want to ask what kind of republic we are, we're a banana republic, okay? We can't pay any of our debts. 47 million to start with, and it becomes 77 million by the end of the 1780s. By the way, if you're a state and you get levied taxes, you don't have to pay. It's voluntary. By the way, each state has its own foreign policy. Massachusetts has its own treaties with England. Rhode Island is running tariffs against New York and Connecticut. I could keep going on, but But the creation of a confederation is the legitimate goal of the revolution, not the creation of a nation. And that confederation is behaving pretty much as I just got through describing to you. We are, well, the government that meets in the Confederation Congress is really a League of Nations. Each state is a separate nation. Adams and Jefferson, writing from abroad, say, nobody believes us in Europe because there's no such thing as the United States, who we represent. By the way, the United States is a plural noun. People don't say the United States is. People say the United States are. We are headed towards the Europeanization of North America. Think EU. And that's what they want. That's what's popular. Patrick Henry said, well, suppose we had a central government and all the delegates from Virginia voted against a tax bill and then everybody else, or it passed, we'd be taxed without our consent. That's how they think. It's like the people in Germany now, why are we paying for Greece? That's the direction that America is headed in the 1780s. The 1780s is a kind of dead zone. Even literate Americans, people in American history, don't understand. It's the single most critical period in American history because four people take the lead in deciding to change the direction in which American history is headed. They are, as have been revealed by Craig, John Jay, the one you probably don't know much about, Madison, James Madison, whom you do, Hamilton, who has become famous again, and if we haven't seen the play, we got to see it, even though it's now too expensive, and most important of all, Mr. Washington. He's an indispensable person in this story. I'm not going to be able to tell the full story here in the brief time I've got. I'll give you just some highlights, there's a lot at stake here, okay? In my judgment, this is the most consequential act of political leadership in American history. That's saying a lot. But if you think about what's going to happen, we're going to get a national government which shifts sovereignty from the states to the federal level. And American Revolution. What happens here in 1776 is not a revolution. It's a war for colonial independence. Those things happen all the time in the 19th and 20th century. We don't call them revolutions. So what makes the American Revolution a revolution? Well, first of all, in order to become an American Revolution, it has to become American. And you have to have a national ethos that overrides the regional and sectional and state-based allegiances. This in a society in which the average American is born, lives out his or her life, and dies within a 28-mile radius. And I have to tell my students this all the time, but I'm sure I don't need to tell you, they didn't have cell phones. There was no Facebook. There's another ingredient that forces the issue and allows me to speak a little bit about the guy I'm trying to build up as somebody deserving of more attention than he's received. He has a criminal justice college named after him in New York, John Jay. Scene. August 1782, Versailles. John Jay and the Spanish minister to the French court, Count Aranda, I always say Orlando, it's not Orlando, Joe, it's Aranda, are looking at a map. It's called the Mitchell map. It's the most accurate map of North America. When the earlier maps are really great, like one of the reasons Virginia thinks its western border is the Pacific, because the early maps show the Pacific about 200 miles west of the Alleghenies. And you got to remember, nobody knows at that stage how big North America is. But they got a pretty accurate map, and Aranda puts his finger on Lake Erie, and he draws a line straight down through Ohio to what is now Tallahassee, Florida. And he says, everything east of that line is yours. Everything west of that line is ours, Spain's. And Jay doesn't have to draw a line. He just points to the Mississippi. He says, everything east of that is ours, everything west is yours, and it's non-negotiable. He's under instructions, as are the whole American delegation. Adams is up in the Netherlands negotiating with the Dutch bankers. Lawrence is captured at sea and is in the tower in London. And Franklin's got the gout and he can't show up, so Jay's doing everything. And if you think about it, when we start what becomes the rebellion against Britain in 75, 76, who thought we were going to get an empire? We weren't doing this for that. But we get one. The great principle in the Treaty of Paris is independence recognized, but the great prize is the transmontane West. At the end of the treaty negotiations, the French and the British sit down together with the Americans, and the French propose a toast to the rising empire in America, because now the United States is bigger than France, Spain, and England put together. And the English say, yes, yes, and they will speak English, every damn one of them, not French. If you have that kind of empire out there in the West, you need a coherent federal government to integrate it into the society. A confederation can't do that. You're going to end up, and you do, get fights. Georgia's down there signing its own treaties with Indian tribes. New England states are worried they're being cut out of the deal. There's a thing called the Mississippi question, blah, 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 blah. But Jay's important because of his role in getting this land, and then he's the head of foreign policy throughout the Confederation Congress. He's superintendent of foreign policy. Important guy. When Washington finally is elected president, and no president in American history did not want to be president more than George Washington. He needs to speak to Mr. Trump these days. And the first person he went to was Jay. He said, what office do you want? State? Whatever. He said, I want to be first Chief Justice. Big mistake. But that's what that's the reason he's got a criminal justice thing. Anyway, we changed the direction in which American history is going. I can't tell you the full story of the Constitutional Convention. There are two ghosts at the banquet. One, they can't stop talking about. That's monarchy. Any robust expression of executive power will be perceived as monarchical. They overlearned the lessons of 76. The second, they can't mention. It's too explosive. It's slavery. It's embedded in the economy of all the states south of the Potomac. I get students at Mount Holyoke and Amherst, slavery's wrong. And the vast majority of people sitting, the 55 delegates, agreed with you, including most of the slave owners. Nobody in the 18th century made the same argument that John C. Calhoun would make in the 19th century, that slavery was a positive good. Nobody said, we don't like it. We all know it violates the values on which the American Revolution is based. Most of them think slavery will die a natural death if you confine it to the Deep South. All we got to do is confine it, shut off the supply, confine it, and it'll die. They think slave labor will not be able to compete successfully with free labor. They don't foresee the cotton gin. They don't foresee the cotton kingdom. and therefore they make a bargain. It's, in the eyes of subsequent abolitionists, a bargain with death or a covenant with death. But here's the hard truth. If they had faced slavery squarely, the document would have never been passed. And it would certainly never have been ratified. So what do you want to do? That's a toughie. But their argument, Washington said, we can start talking about slavery in 20 years when we end the slave trade. The ratifying conventions, by the way, nobody got what they wanted in September of 1787. It's a series of compromises. There are two groups in the convention, Confederationists and Nationalists. The Confederationists want a reform of the Articles. The Nationalists want to replace the Articles. The Nationalists are essentially illegal because the mandate from the Confederation Congress is to reform the Articles, not to replace them. Washington is the big prize. If you didn't get Washington, this whole thing is really illegitimate. Washington legitimizes what is essentially a nonviolent coup d'etat, an overthrow of the existing government, and gives it his own mark of distinction. And when he goes in, he says to Madison, and they meet for a week here beforehand because storms are delaying the arrival of most of the other delegates. He gets a promise, we're going for broke. No compromise, no middle position. We're not about to reform the Articles, we're going to replace them. I'm not investing all my prestige. And this is a big deal for him because Cincinnatus is not supposed to come back. Cincinnatus never comes back. And he's coming back. He gets that promise, and that's how you get the Virginia Plan. I can't go into this in detail. What happens is a series of compromises. Both the Senate and the House and the Electoral College reflect that compromise. The discussion of executive power and the Electoral College takes all this time. If you could bring them back, and we can't, they're busy being dead, okay? And the one thing I would think they would be surprised that we still hold on to is the Electoral College. They wanted to do a direct election, but they couldn't do it logistically. Distance was too much of a problem. And then the Electoral College is a gesture to state power. I'd love to see a new convention to do this, but of course that's impossible. The Constitutional Convention worked for all the reasons that would now be inadmissible. 55 white guys with a lot of money and power gathered together in total secrecy and didn't let anybody know what they were doing. Impossible to do that. The ratifying conventions are, in some sense, the great debate in American history. 12 states, Rhode Island boycotts everything. Rhode Island is really, you know, like I sent a kid to Brown at Providence, in Providence, Rhode Island, and Massachusetts doesn't want you to get to Rhode Island. And that's where they send the witches and the Quakers and the antinomians. And it's only recently that you could really get down there. And the pattern in all the states is the most interesting thing. There is no pattern. Every state is different. And within every state, every county is different. We cannot have a national conversation because we're not really a nation. The only national volume is the Federalist Papers. That's what makes it distinctive. And everybody thinks this is the great deliberation on American politics. These things were written at lightning speed. These were all-nighters performed by these three guys. Madison, Hamilton, and Jay. And Hamilton's wife says he wrote the first five on the top of a barrel riding on a boat from Albany to New York City. Anyway, it's passed, and the Bill of Rights becomes an insurance policy for, well, Many states in the ratification process say, we want to ratify with amendments. And Madison says, you can't do that. It's aye or nay, up or down. They say, well, how about recommended amendments? He says, okay. What you got to do is ratify and then make recommended amendments. And so seven states do this, recommending about 210 amendments, depending on how you count, and there's a lot of overlap. What Madison does when to write the Bill of Rights is to look at what those amendments were and to say, what can I take here to show these states that are reluctant that we've heard them? He doesn't really believe in the Bill of Rights. He thinks it's what he called paper barriers. He doesn't think republics need a Bill of Rights because monarchies need Bill of Rights to protect the people from royal power. But the power, the thing you got to worry about in republics is popular movements up from the bottom. Those are what Tocqueville called tyranny of the majority. That's what he's worried about. And he doesn't think that the Bill of Rights is going to stop that. But six states recommend, this is great, that all taxes be voluntary. We go back to the articles, okay? He just deep sixes that one. And he tries to put in his favorite thing, the executive veto of state legislation. And that also gets knocked, the Senate knocks that out. There's one that's controversial now. It's the Second Amendment. And the Second Amendment, and we might want to talk about this, is a response to four states that have objected to national defense being in the hands of a professional army, what they would call a standing army, the British Army or the Continental Army. And the Second Amendment represents Madison's attempt to assure those states that national defense will be in the hands of state militia. Like when the War of 1812 comes, Massachusetts militia says, we ain't going to Canada. You know, every state has its own militia. There's a danger in that. You know, it doesn't really represent. The decision made in D.C. versus Heller, the majority opinion by Mr. Justice Scalia, argues quite the opposite. It argues that the Second Amendment recognizes the existence of the right to bear arms as a natural right. That's not what Madison intended. That's not what the other people were thinking. That's not how the people who ratified it thought. It's a derivative right deriving from service in the militia. That's what the Supreme Court has decided for 200 years until 2008. The decision that most people in the NRA think, hallelujah, is really a preposterous decision. I'll stop there.
Thank you. So I want to start by asking you, it is commonly stated, commonly assumed, that Madison is the father of the Constitution. I know that you have there may be another contestant for the honor.
Yeah, I mean, I think you can, Madison as father of the Constitution is a very plausible position. But the irony is that I think he achieves that status before the convention begins and after it's over. That is to say, he's the guy that creates the Virginia plan that in the spring of 87 that becomes the agenda, and that's a huge contribution. And then as a participant in the Federalist Papers, and then as the author of the Bill of Rights, he sort of secures it. The two things he cares most about during the convention, he loses. A federal veto of state laws and equal representation in both branches of the legislature. Those are non-negotiable as far as he's concerned. Both losers for him. There is another candidate that's my favorite, and and he's a weird guy, but his name is Gouverneur Morris. If you've ever been down to Richmond and you see the statue of Washington in front of the Virginia State House, it's done by Houdon, the great French sculptor, and it's Washington. Well, it's Washington's head, because he took a face mask of Washington, came all the way over. But the torso is Gouverneur Morris, because Morris has the same size as Washington. He was 6'3¼". Although Morris had a peg leg. And they, of course, took the peg leg off. But, and he's a bit of a raconteur, a bit of a rake. But in August of 17, nobody speaks more often than Gouverneur Morris. He rises to speak more than any other delegate, including Madison. Madison's second. He is the most articulate and outspoken enemy of slavery in the debates. And this is the biggie. This would be a great question for Jeopardy that nobody would get right. Who wrote the Constitution? Gouverneur Morris. The Committee of Style was appointed to take all the drafts. Have I done something here? Gouverneur Morris's spirit is coming back. To take all the drafts and put them together and synthesize them. In this committee, this style committee, Committee on Style, okay, great, I'd love to be on that. And Madison's on it and Hamilton's on it, and they say, Morris, you do it. He says, okay, it takes him 2 days. He synthesizes all kinds of stuff and gives it the look it has before. It's really kind of pedantic. But the first sentence that he's working with, what he's working with says, we the people of the states of Massachusetts, New Hampshire, Rhode Island, Connecticut, down the Atlantic coast. He changes that on his own without anybody looking. We the people of the United States. Now that's what the whole daggone argument has been about, right? He just does it. I would argue this is the greatest editorial change in American publishing. And so I think I want to give him at least a heads up as a candidate for the title of a father of the Constitution.
So let's stay with history for a bit before we turn to how this all sort of applies to the present.
Oh my God.
So in your book, you argue that Washington thought that the West, the empire granted in the treaty, was the basis for a continental nation, the requirement of a continental nation. Hamilton thought it was the debt and the need to deal with the debt. Who do you think was right, or were they both right?
They're both right. And that, Washington starts his whole life as a French and Indian war guy out there, and then before that, a surveyor. So Washington is among the founders. He's the one most attuned to the West. And you think about it, you know, like Adams goes to Harvard and Jefferson goes to William and Mary. Washington goes to war. And so what that world out there is huge for him. By the way, he also owns about 60,000 acres out there that's going to go up in value once this becomes part of the United States, given to him by service in the French and Indian War. But at the end of the war, when Lafayette has just left, and he writes back to Washington and on the ship heading over to France, he says, oh, by the way, I want you to come over to Europe and do the grand tour with me. You're famous over here. And we'll go to Paris, and we'll go to Vienna, and we'll go to Rome. I don't think we're going to go to London, but Washington says, no, you come back, and we'll go to Detroit, and we'll go to New Orleans, and we'll swing around, and we'll go to Florida, and then we'll go up to Savannah. That's the future. That's the real grand tour. He sees that. Before Frederick Jackson Turner talks about the West, Washington understands the whole thing. The notion, and the irony is, that's also the answer to the debt. Because we're going to make, in modern terms, hundreds of billions of dollars in selling that land. I mean, one of the reasons we don't have to have an income tax until 1913
is they got the revenue coming from Western land throughout the 19th century. That's a huge deal. And Hamilton understands that. And Hamilton thinks continentally. You know, he does. And that's the reason you need a bank to manage all this stuff, so that these aren't opposites. These are interacting different ways of talking about the same larger vision.
So I want to ask sort of a series of questions where I'd like you to sort of bring your historian's eye and your expertise on this creation of the United States to the present political situation that we have. So you said in your remarks, much of what the Quartet and the other delegates did was of questionable legality. Mm. You used the phrase nonviolent coup d'etat.
Right. I mean, two ways. Like, they weren't mandated to replace, but only to revise. And according to the existent document, the Articles of Confederation, in order to amend it, you needed a unanimous vote. Well, they just said, screw the unanimous vote. We're going to take nine, because we'll never get a unanimous vote. That was their decision, but that was unconstitutional in some but it was a purely practical thing. By the way, the whole ratifying convention, it's get to nine. Get to nine. New York's never going to ratify. It's 3-1 against there. Rhode Island is not going to ratify. Probably North Carolina's not going to ratify. Virginia's really close. Let's get to nine before we get to Virginia. And they do by one state. New Hampshire goes. So it's like once you got to nine, it's a dead question. The rest of them are forced to come in. At least that's what they think. If Virginia had been, if they didn't get to nine, and Virginia had stayed out, and it's a close vote, it's, you know, about 186 to 178, I don't know whether it would have worked, because Virginia is such a huge state, both population and economy. And remember, it includes West Virginia and Kentucky. But get to nine. All right, I interrupted your question.
No. So the question is, there are people who look at the contemporary political gridlock in Congress and who make an argument that we have reformed ourselves into ungovernability, that many of the things that our founders did in the Constitutional Convention, that many of the things that Lincoln did to save the Republic in the Civil War would now be crimes. And so I guess I'm asking from a historian's point of view whether you think there's some legitimacy to the view that sometimes reforms can become handcuffs for the kind of dynamic political process that works.
You're putting it in a different way than the way I normally hear a version of that question. The normal version I hear is that maybe it's the fault of the founders that we've got this gridlocked government, okay? And there's some truth in that, because we've created, if we had a parliamentary system, and that's what all the Europeans can't understand, that the norm now is you're going to get a president, and then the opposite party will control either one or both branches of the legislature. That's a recipe for gridlock. Checks and balances, okay. But my answer, which goes to the real way you phrased it, is that most of the sources of blockage, I mean, another way to put it is if you look at societies and governments now, which of them have the most difficult time passing things? They're republics that are bicameral. If you split the legislature, now Britain has two, but the Lord of the House of Lords doesn't count anymore, but that you get two ambush sites that way. But I would say that the two things that we've done in the 20th century that really make it difficult and paralysis almost is the norm is the filibuster, especially in the way the filibuster has evolved in the late 20th century, the silent filibuster. All you got to do is say, to stop it, and you don't even have to identify yourself. The other is now, I think they're going to rename this, the Hafford Rule, Danny Hafford, and that the Speaker doesn't have to report a bill from the House if his caucus, a majority of his caucus, doesn't support it, even if a majority of overall delegates does. So that's, for example, that's how they killed the carbon retention bill. That's how that died. It never got reported back. And so that I think we've done this to ourselves. This, not to mention the fact that it's a plutocracy. I mean, like, back in, we're worse than it was in the Gilded Age. Like, in the Gilded Age, Mark Hanna was asked, you know, what's really important in American politics? What's the ironclad principle? He said, there are two principles. The first is money. I cannot remember what the second is. And that, we're there. We have, and people don't even apologize for it, you know? I mean, I want them to put it on the screen every time something goes on, you know, like, let's say the Senate Majority Leader gets up to oppose climate change. The amount of money he gets from the coal industry, or the amount of money he's taken from the Koch brothers. I mean, on the other side, labor unions, too. I want to see it so that people are held accountable to what is really. And if you're a, if you go into the House of Representatives now, the first thing the Speaker says is, I expect you to spend 70% of your time raising money. Really? Yeah, 70% of my your time. Because you're not just raising it for yourself, you're raising it for your party, too. So, plutocracy, ambush sites, and then some of the things we've done, and then there are things, if you brought them back, again, I keep saying, doing that is like, trying to do that is like trying to plant cut flowers. You know, they're not gonna take seed here, and there's no such thing as a time machine, and let's get serious about that. We have to go back to them. They can't come forward to us. It's irresistible, though, to bring them forward and say, would you really keep this thing called the Electoral College? And I'm convinced, because I know what they said in August of 87. They hated it. It was, you know, if they knew they had digital communications and telegraphs and all that stuff and you could get the vote recorded, I'm sure they would do away with that.
So that leads to a question again about the present political situation. Both parties are arguing that one of the most important stakes of this election is control of the Supreme Court. And essentially, they're making an argument based on the idea that there will be a different philosophy used to select justices and therefore different outcomes of cases. So I want to ask you, what is the original intent about the idea of original intent?
This is going to upset people. I'll before I lose my little barrage here, I will soften it up a little bit. Say one thing: if you read the Constitution, try to figure out what the power of the judiciary is. It's impossible. It's not in the Constitution. It's in the way in which it was shaped, not so much by Jay or his successor, but by Marshall. That's the reason Marshall's the greatest Chief Justice in American history. The one thing they would agree on is that, this is interesting because it relates to original intent. One thing they would all agree on is that the Supreme Court is not supreme. It doesn't have the right to decide what the Constitution means. Every branch of government has that right. Executive branch, legislative branch, or judicial branch. That's what they all said. They said that, okay? So the notion that one branch of the government, so that all these guys that believe in original intent in their purest, Thomas and Scalia, God rest his soul, they would have to recuse themselves. Plus, and I'm going to sound a little historian, like, if you take originalism seriously, and it means that you're going to recover either the intention or what Scalia calls the meaning of the words. They are ill-equipped to do that. They're not historians. If you really want to go with original intent, you ought to be a historian. Now, they don't believe that, of course. I mean, and so I think the doctrine of original intent is, what upsets me about it is that there's the living Constitution, and then there's originalists. And Scalia, he said, I believe in the dead Constitution, right? Well, first of all, why? Because in this room, tongues of fire appeared over people at a certain time and gave them divine insights that will never be shared by anybody else? Well, that's nonsense. Of course, that's not true. Do you believe that? He believes that. That's the only reason that you want to go back to that, right? And I can tell you, if you let me, if you give me, I can do this with the Bible or the Constitution. You tell me the conclusion you want on any major issue, and I will find the evidence to support it. Either side. And so what ends up happening is cherry picking. And when Roberts was being appointed or being interviewed by the Senate Judiciary Committee, you remember the famous thing about, I'm just an umpire, I don't set the strikes on, and overly clever responses. Mr. Justice Roberts, they didn't have baseball then. There was no strike zone, okay? And the irony is that if you ask them, and all of them, I mean, all the prominent founders, the ones that I've just written about, but all the, you know, George Mason, Patrick Henry, by the way, is opposed to the Constitution, they would say that the one thing that we all agree on is that our intentions should not be binding on subsequent generations. That we don't want to freeze it. Jefferson says it would be like asking an adult to wear children's clothes. And Jefferson believed you ought to redo the Constitution every 21 years, okay? Every generation should be sovereign. He's a radical. But Adams, so that the original, if you try to get an explanation of the originalist doctrine, it's a point of view that developed at the University of Chicago in the 70s, that's part of a conservative movement that then was heavily funded by the Koch brothers. And that it's not connected to anything in the 18th century. It's connected to the modern conservative movement, the American Enterprise Society, the Federalist Society, the Cato Society. That's where it comes from. It is an ideological, politically based movement. And it's no accident that all those people appointed by Republicans vote conservative. And those people appointed by Democrats vote liberal. I would make the same case about Brown versus Board of Education. What upsets me is the conservatives claim that they're totally impartial. The conservatives claim that, you know, they're the ones who are reading the Constitution. Nobody can do that. It is psychologically and intellectually impossible for you to do that. And so it's irritating to me to have to, I know I'm going to have to listen to that, no matter who the nominee is, whenever they hear this person, either before the next president is appointed or afterwards. And I think we ought to take this on head on. Like, originalism isn't just problematic, okay? Originalism is utterly preposterous.
Thank you. Okay, so another one.
Sorry about that. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's what you're here for.
All right. Good. Am I getting paid for this, by the way? Yeah.
No.
No, I'm not getting paid. What
can we learn from the degree of compromise that the founders were willing to accept? Maybe even endure would be the word. I mean, the original sin of the United States is slavery.
Yeah.
Yet today, compromise on far less serious matters is seen as the dereliction of moral duty.
There's a whole school of thought, a lot, and especially among politically correct student bodies. You know, the notion that compromise on slavery is acceptable is unacceptable. And if you go back to the 1790s, and I wrote a book about this called Founding Brothers, that's really heavy-duty partisan stuff going on there, really, you know, heavy, you know, scandal-mongering and all that stuff. But, they do compromise on this document that was crafted here. And what they create that's wonderful is See, the Constitution doesn't make us a nation. The Constitution creates the framework for a federal government where we can grow into being a nation. The Constitution doesn't provide answers. The Constitution provides a framework in which we can argue together. That's what it really is. It's not a set of answers. Madison comes to understand it in the in like Federalist 43, 44, 45. You can say, oh my God, if I got what I wanted, it would have never passed. It would never be ratified. Okay? And so like Madison was like, say, we here agree that there's the federal government and there's a line that separates federal and state jurisdiction. Yeah, but nobody agrees where it's drawn. Nobody. And it'll shift on specific issues. And he said, we'll figure it out on a case-by-case basis, and damn it, we're still doing that. But to me, what I would, this is a singular little answer to your question. Before every session of the Congress of the United States, they used to read Washington's farewell address up until sometime in the 70s, I think. They should read Franklin's final speech at this place. He's lying on a bier, and he doesn't read it himself because he's got the gout, and James Wilson actually reads it. It's one of the most elegiac things that Franklin ever wrote. And it's about how he's going to vote for this, even though he's not sure it's the right thing, but he's not sure that it's not the right thing. And that what makes the founders different from current people, especially one of the candidates for the presidency, they all recognize their own depravity. That is to say, that there's nobody, I mean, that we're all people who have our flaws. And therefore, I cannot impose my agenda in a complete way because I know that it might be wrong. And Franklin gives voice to that. And I don't think reading this in front of the Congress is going to make a whit of difference, but it makes me feel better.
Last question from me, and then we'll open to our audience. Along the same lines, what can we learn from the fact that the founders were interested in a republic, but were disdainful of the idea of democracy?
They were, too.
And in the current political environment, we see the emergence of bottom-up movements in both parties of considerable strength, rocking the establishments of their parties. What would the founders have thought of this degree of democracy?
Oh, boy. I think a lot of ways I can carry that, but that'd be historic, first of all. Res publica, things of the public. The public is different from the people. The public is the long-term interest of the people, which at any given moment, most of the people don't understand. Okay? Let's create a government framework that has a democratic base, but filters popular opinion through different layers of filtration so that the public interest will emerge at the end. And so the House is directly elected. The Senate is originally elected by state legislatures. The president is elected in the far away. The courts are, the Supreme Court is furthest away from popular opinion. So that this notion of filtration, so that the democracy is the fountain, but we purify the water as it rises through these layers. And I think that nobody could have foreseen the modern media, even in our lifetimes, the way in which we're all being bombarded by images on a constant basis. I've just been through 7 airports, and everybody that I've ever seen is on a telephone. Nobody's talking to anybody with the telephone, and. That this is going to trail off in a way that I don't like, but that in some sense, I think what they say is, we told you so. got to build protections against demagogues. Well, for example, it's too easy to go to war now. They made it really hard to go to war. They made it really hard to get a constitutional amendment passed, too. But, like, we haven't gone to war the way the Constitution says since December 8, 1941. And we've gone to all these wars. And I think the role that money plays in politics is just, they would think it's impossible for them to imagine. But in this, we've become a democratic culture. It is impossible to win an argument in a democratic culture arguing for the few rather than the many. In their world, you could win that argument. We can't win it in our world. And you have to do it in insidious ways or indirect ways. But the way I do it as a historian, I say, I want us to be a republic. I want the public interest to be the deciding factor. And I'm worried about excesses in democracy. If that makes me, I'm not a conservative, but that's what it sounds like it makes. That's what a real conservative should believe. But that's not what the modern American Conservative Party believes. I'm fading into extraneous things here, and I don't have an answer because I think that they would, if you brought them here and showed them a mall, they would not know what to do.
Okay, we're going to open it to questions from the audience. We have microphones on either side so everybody can be heard. Don't be bashful. Step up.
I've been turning my back to all these people over here. I'm sorry. We were so profound that we've answered all these questions.
Answered
that,
every question there is.
That people might have.
Anybody?
Yes.
Can you come up so we can... There's a mic over here. Sure. Thank you.
I'm not even sure what my question is, but I'm very interested because I've seen the analogies with Andrew Jackson and the Jacksonian...
You mean with current candidate?
Yes.
Yeah.
And sort of what's happening...
Begins with a T? Yeah.
Yeah. And sort of your take on, because I think it was a really significant shift.
Yeah, it was.
That occurred there. And...
Well, Jefferson and Adams
so
were,
I'll
both,
let you answer.
Were both. Jefferson and Adams were both alive when that happened. When the Jackson was rising, and they both called him a barbarian. And his only achievement was to kill Indians. There was a long profile in Atlantic magazine by some psychologist of Trump. I found it banal myself, and. But the one guy he compared him to in presidential is Jackson. Jackson actually served a term in Congress, however. And Jackson served, you know, in the military in a big way. In my judgment, there's no candidate of a major party, candidate for the presidency by a major party in the history of the United States who has as unprepared and misaligned as Donald Trump. We've never had somebody like that before, even Jackson. And it's a media creation. It's also racism. He knows how to play that really well.
Mitchell, you wanted to?
Thank you for a very interesting presentation. If there was to be a constitutional convention today, could you give a couple examples of how you think our founders would want to deal with issues like money and politics or other aspects that way?
The predicate, or the premise of your question is inadmissible.
Okay.
There cannot be another convention. It is impossible. The very reasons that this convention succeeded is because it was secretive and select and untransparent and non-diverse. and any movement for another convention would fall victim to the very problems it attempts to solve. Therefore, it is not in the realm of possibility. You can write novels about it, and try to imagine what might happen, but I'm a poor novelist, so I don't really have an answer. I mean, I think it's just not in the realm of possibility.
Thank you. It's probably a poorly phrased question, then. Then maybe, even without a convention that way, are there a couple recommendations, do you think, that some of the founding fathers would have made to deal with our problems of today?
Yeah. Now, remember what I said. They're dead. They're busy being dead. We can't bring them forward. There are no such things as time machines, and there never will be. Right. Therefore, what we can do is go back to them and try to read them and read the primary sources, not what historians like me make of them, but the primary sources. And as I do that, I've indicated one thing that I think that they would say is, let's get rid of the Electoral College and go for a direct election of the president. Now, after that, I talk about how everybody's just cherry-picking. I will demonstrate that I'm cherry-picking the whole thing, and I would start talking about getting money out of politics, revoking Citizens United, one of the worst decisions in American jurisprudence. But that's me, okay? I'm using me and pretending it's the founders. And I can find it in the founders, but I'm sure you can find other stuff too.
Gotcha.
And but the thing that's clearest to me, because they said it then, is the current way we elect the president was a, they knew it was a Rube Goldberg contraption in 1787, 88, and it's now an anachronism, and yet we're stuck with it. And oh, it wouldn't take a new convention, but it would take a constitutional amendment. And unfortunately, the small states, especially the small states, will block it because it limits their power. And therefore, it'll never get passed. It'll never get ratified.
Thank you.
It's like, this is the story of my life. Does this happen to you now? I have all these great ideas, and I know they can't happen. They're blocked.
I want to see if I can come over here, if there's anybody who wants to step up over here. Please. Thank you.
Thank you. These days we hear a great deal about abuse of executive power. Can you give us some examples on how today's presidency executive is really a different beast than it was in Washington's time?
That's biggie. It's a good question. That's a question that seems to me people on both sides can talk about. The founders, there's a split in the founders. It's a split between the Jeffersonian Republicans and the Federalists. It's Jefferson and then Madison who switches sides in a really about face that's 180 degrees in the 1790s, and then Washington, Adams, and Hamilton. The first group, the Republicans, believe that any exercise of executive power is inherently tyrannical and monarchical. They believe, in fact, that the federal government has no power to make domestic policy at all. So from the beginning, there's a split about executive power. And Washington is accused of being an elected monarch. He rides around New York and then Philadelphia in a, well, you know, with a, you know, a carriage that's being driven by four, you know, beautiful white horses and leopard skin saddles and all this stuff. And he looks the part. People want to ask me about what is Washington as a young man look like. I say, think John Wayne in Stagecoach circa 1939. He's a stud, man. And when Gilbert Stuart painted his portrait, you get this iconic image. He painted six different portraits of Washington, but that when he was painting the first one, he said, as I looked into his eyes, and he has things about his eyes, he is like the wildest animal in the forest. But he didn't paint that. He painted this, you know, this other. Anyway, I think that executive power in the history of the United States is supposed to be kept under pretty tight constraint, except in crises, and then it's allowed like an accordion to expand. So Lincoln, FDR, yes. Then, with the Cold War and the creation of the national security state and essentially perpetual wartime conditions, that the power of the executive has grown enormously because of that. And now we go to war by delegating to the commander-in-chief the right to go to war. We don't even have a vote in both houses of Congress. So that the power of the executive is much, much more than it ever was or ever was imagined to be in late 18th century. And it's a function of the Cold War initially, because remember, we were, you know, whoever pressed the button destroyed the world, or that you had to be able to respond. You couldn't put things, let's debate this in Congress. Well, the missiles were coming in, you know. You couldn't do that. Well, we really changed that atmosphere, but we haven't changed the attitude towards executive power in a security state. It's excessive. It's excessive, I think.
It was back here. Gentleman in the back, if you would.
I can. Jane Meyer, yeah.
Do you think
I think this is to some extent the debate inside the Democratic Party right now, and in terms of Hillary versus Bernie. But I mean, I think that the level of income inequality that's grown up in the last 30 years and the hollowing out of the middle class, the salvation is, this is a weird way to put it, we're killing the American dream. And you can't do that in America. It cannot sustain. Something has to happen to recover the belief that people have that if they work hard and do their best, that they have a legitimate shot at a middle-class life. That's been destroyed for an awful lot of people, and you cannot destroy that and still be America. So, like right now, I would say we're a plutocracy. But we were a plutocracy in the Gilded Age, too, and somebody came along, Franklin Roosevelt. We need a crisis to do it. But the path we're on is unsustainable. And it's not just unsustainable politically, it's unsustainable economically. A consumer culture cannot continue to be a growing culture if the middle class is reduced, because the middle class is the consumers. And so we're killing the goose that lays the golden egg. And you can't do that, even if you're a finance capitalist. You don't want to do that. But that's where we're at. I'm optimistic that that's going to change, because it has to. But I can't tell you how. Bernie's not going to win.
We have time for just one more question. I just want to make sure there's none over here. This light is sort of blinding in this direction for me. So if there's anybody over here. Okay.
No, they're behind.
Then we have one more gentleman here. Thank you.
According to some people, no. That's a Yeah, that's a good question to end on, really, in the sense that when Gouverneur Morris wrote that, there were 3.5 million Americans. Now there's 320 million. Of the 3.5 million, 600,000 were African Americans. And they had no rights at all. Now you figure 50% were women, and they had no rights. And then you had to have property to vote. Now, did Morris mean just citizen? To be a citizen, you had to have property, be white, and be male. That knocks it down to about 600,000. But is that what he's talking about there? I don't know. We don't. Nobody thought of asking him to clarify what he meant.
Can you go back and ask him?
Well, you know, and DNA studies are great, but they don't give you that kind of information. I do think you're making a point which has some troubling implications, because of the founders, not a single one that I've studied believed that it was possible to create a biracial American society. Even those that want to end slavery right away want to deport all the blacks to the Caribbean or Africa. You read Uncle Tom's Cabin, right? Harriet Beecher Stowe. It's got an appendix. This is where we're going to send them. The idea that we're a biracial society is a mid-20th century idea. I mean, it's gained mainstream acceptance in the mid-20th century. And as we approach a point in 2015, white Caucasians will be a minority. Boy, that's going to be interesting. And I think what we're seeing now in certain circles of the mainstream political process is a form of racism that's like dog whistles, but we all know what it's about. And there's a lot of people that don't want to acknowledge that that's the income, that's the racial future of the United States. And it's baked in, it's gonna happen. And we know that, the demography is not gonna change. And I'd like to set up a poll somewhere in the middle of the field and say, we the people means everybody. And I think that's a winning position. It's a winning position, and that is the most optimistic thing I think I've ever said. Thank you.
And we'll end on that. Thank you.